Well, good morning, church. It's nice to see all of you, and welcome to those of you that are joining us online. Why don't we stand together and take a few moments just to quiet our hearts, to allow ourselves to fully arrive. If there's anything that's distracting you or holding you back, I would just encourage you to lay those things at Jesus' feet, and then I'll read our call to worship in a few moments here. Psalm 145, verses 1 through 7 says, I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and exalt your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, most worthy of our praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. They will speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and will meditate on your wonderful works. They will tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They will celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. Let's sing together. Holy is the Lord.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we is good. He's above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise.
With a mighty hand and outstretched arms,
His love endures forever.
And for the life that has been reborn,
His love endures forever. Sing praise.
God is faithful,
forever God is strong,
forever God is with us,
forever,
and forever God is faithful,
forever God is strong,
forever God is with us,
forever. God, we will carry on.
His love endures forever.
Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise.
Forever God is faithful.
Forever God is strong.
Forever God is with us.
Forever.
Forever God is faithful.
Forever God is strong.
Forever God is with us.
Forever.
Just me.
do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
God, we thank you for that promise. Thank you that you love us. Thank you that you always provide for us. And so we give ourselves to you this morning. May you receive our worship. We pray those things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
It's good to be back. We were in the promised land for a little while, Nova Scotia. And we were in Canaan. We drove past Garden of Eden, but it wasn't really the Holy Land or anything. But now there has been flooding there, so we pray for our brothers and sisters there in Nova Scotia, New Brunswick, PEI, and Quebec, I guess. Let's come together for a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we honor you with our worship. We praise you for who you are. You are our Messiah, our wonderful counselor, our glorious King, name above all names. We know the day is coming when at your name, Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that you, Jesus Christ, are Lord to the glory of God the Father. We praise you today for this day. You woke us up and you brought us here to worship together as a community. Lord, we praise you for the rain and the sun that causes the grass and the flowers to grow, the trees to show their beauty. Lord, we praise you for answers to prayer this week. Lord, you are so faithful. And we praise you for the abundant life we can live because of what you've done on the cross. Lord, we repent now for time that we've spent away from you. We've gone without doing our daily devotions sometimes, or our prayers, or talking to you. Lord, forgive us for that. Help us to be better at meeting with you day after day. We ask forgiveness for the sins we committed this week. Sometimes sins that are obvious to us and to others, but sometimes when we have been deceived by the evil one and gone his way instead of yours. Sometimes our sins are those of omission. We neglect to do things we should, things that you put in front of us, but we miss due to our busyness or the many distractions in our life and are reminded of it later. Lord, forgive us for sins of omission. Lord, we ask that for those leading worship today that you bless them. Our worship team, Pastor Jamal, as he brings the message, the tech team, the ushers, the greeters, the Power Up Children's Ministry team, all those involved in this service. Fill them with your Holy Spirit, Lord, and help them to look to you for direction. Lord, you know there is a need for youth and children's ministry leaders, the next generation of the church. We pray for Pastor Amaris and for Antoinette not to grow discouraged, but to trust in you through these uncertain times. Call your people, Lord, to work in youth, children's, adult, marriage ministries, and other ministries of this church. You are faithful to provide for our needs. We pray for those who are looking for work, Lord. There are so many. Be our provider, Lord. Be our encourager and our strength in these difficult times. Lord, we pray for those who are ill or in hospital. We pray for your healing, your mercy to fall on them, your peace to rest in their heart. Lord, we pray for Donald Trump and the people of the United States after this assassination attempt. Lord, we just pray that you would give them peace and just not the spirit of retribution or retaliation, but the spirit of peace and love and just protection for the people there. Lord, we pray for our missionary of the month, Lindell Campbell Requia, who is serving as a seminary professor in Brazil. Would you minister to her and give her peace as she teaches, give her joy in the journey, give her just an extra measure of protection, Lord, in that difficult country. Lord, we pray for fresh manna churches in Kenya. We pray for your provision for them, for leadership to take the reins and to go with the leadership of the church, for growth, Lord. Thank you for the growth that you have shown to the people of Fresh Manna. We pray for your blessing over them. We pray for our church family, that you would continue to unify the members, that you would grow each person and each family in their walk with you, Jesus, that you would cause all of us to seek you day after day in all we say and all we do. Lord, we pray for Pastor Darren and Pastor Nelson as they are in at the triennial conference, Lord. We pray that you would bless them with just interaction with other pastors and leaders in the Church of the North American Baptist Association. Lord, I pray for the speakers that you would give them encouragement and just speak to them, Lord, and show us where we're going in the days to come. Father, we yield to your will today. Show us your path. Guide us in your ways. In the time leading up to your arrival here on earth, let us be found faithful to you and your word. Help us to be bold in sharing your good news. Like John the Baptist, behold the Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. Give us wisdom in our circumstances this week, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we want to welcome you here and also those who are worshiping online. I invite the person on the left side of each row to reach down and get the connection pad that's in front of you and sign it. You can just put your name if you're a regular person here, but if you're a visitor, fill out as much information as you would like to on that. If you're new to Steele Heights, we invite you to check off the first-time visitor box on the connection sheet and fill in any contact information you'd like to provide. Please also stop by the Welcome Center for a gift and any questions you may have about the church. Baptism involves sharing your faith story, and it's an act of obedience symbolizing a believer's new life in Christ. If you're interested in finding out more about baptism, I'll be having a baptism class at 12:30 after the second service today in the boardroom. So please come if you're at all interested. Young adults and youth are invited to a worship night next Sunday, July 21st, from 6:30 to 10 p.m. at the church. And I heard the last one was just beautiful. So if you're a young adult or a youth, please come to that worship night next Sunday night at 6:30. Our first NeighborFest event of the year is coming up on Wednesday, August 7th from 6:30 to 8:30 at our church. The theme is Treasure Island, so everyone is invited to come and enjoy the festivities. We are also looking for volunteers to help out as we create a memorable and uplifting experience for our community. Please check out the sign-up sheet in the lobby on the wall to find out opportunities where you may serve. We are excited to share the wonderful news of a baby girl born to Joseph Beniza and Ange Mugenza on July 5th. Her name is Ariel Holly Beniza. So when you see Ange and Joseph, just congratulate them. Okay, so let's pray together for our offering. Heavenly Father, thank you for your good gifts you give to us every day. Lord, we give back to you now just a portion of that, that you can use it to glorify your kingdom, Lord. We pray for our community and our world as we give to you in this way. We thank you for what you're going to do with these gifts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We encourage you to take any posture you would like to continue your time of worship as we sing, Because He Lives.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior there. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives.
Okay day today, but I miss the sun. Hope it comes back again. So today we're going to continue with our series. We've been talking about living out our mission. So we're going to listen to Acts chapter 19, verse 8 to 41. So I'm going to invite you. We're going to listen to the reading.
Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them. He took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years, so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick, and their illnesses were cured, and the evil spirits left them. Some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who were demon-possessed. They would say,
"In the name of the Jesus whom Paul preaches, I command you to come out."
7 sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. One day the evil spirit answered them,
"Jesus I know, and Paul I know about, but who are you?"
Then the man who had the evil spirit jumped on them and overpowered them all. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding. When this became known to the Jews and Greeks living in Ephesus, they were all seized with fear, and the name of the Lord Jesus was held in high honor. Many of those who believed now came and openly confessed what they had done. A number who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. When they calculated the value of the scrolls, the total came to 50,000 drachmas. In this way, the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power. After all this had happened, Paul decided to go to Jerusalem, passing through Macedonia and Achaia.
"After I have been there," he said, "I must visit Rome also."
He sent 2 of his helpers, Timothy and Erastus, to Macedonia, while he stayed in the province of Asia a little longer. About that time, there arose a great disturbance about the way. A silversmith named Demetrius, who made silver shrines of Artemis, brought in a lot of business for the craftsmen there. He called them together, along with the workers in related trades, and said,
"You know, my friends, that we receive a good income from this business. And you see and hear how this fellow Paul has convinced and led astray large numbers of people here in Ephesus and in practically the whole province of Asia. He says that gods made by human hands are no gods at all. There is danger not only that our trade will lose its good name, but also that the temple of the great goddess Artemis will be discredited, and the goddess herself, who is worshipped throughout the province of Asia and the world, will be robbed of her divine majesty."
When they heard this, they were furious and began shouting,
"Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!"
Soon the whole city was in an uproar. The people seized Gaius and Aristarchus, Paul's traveling companions from Macedonia, and all of them rushed into the theater together. Paul wanted to appear before the crowd, but the disciples would not let him. Even some of the officials of the province, friends of Paul, sent him a message begging him not to venture into the theater. The assembly was in confusion. Some were shouting one thing, some another. Most of the people did not even know why they were there. The Jews in the crowd pushed Alexander to the front, and they shouted instructions to him. He motioned for silence in order to make a defense before the people. But when they realized he was a Jew, they all shouted in unison for about 2 hours,
"Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!"
The city clerk quieted the crowd and said,
"Fellow Ephesians, doesn't all the world know that the city of Ephesus is the guardian of the temple of the great Artemis and of her image which fell from heaven? Therefore, since these facts are undeniable, you ought to calm down and not do anything rash. You have brought these men here, though they have neither robbed temples nor blasphemed our goddess. If then Demetrius and his fellow craftsmen have a grievance against anybody, the courts are open and there are proconsuls. They can press charges. If there is anything further you want to bring up, it must be settled in a legal assembly. As it is, we are in danger of being charged with rioting because of what happened today. In that case, we would not be able to account for this commotion, since there is no reason for it.
After he had said this, he dismissed the assembly. Chapter 20.
It's a very long passage. Today we're going to continue with living out our mission. And I like the book of Acts because it gives us a picture of what that's going to look like. Because, you know, what they went through that time, the missionaries at that time, Paul in his missionary journeys, is the same thing we're going to go through in our lives as well. Because people are the same. People don't change. They express themselves differently, but people are always the same. And today, I want us to look at two things here. One of the ways that the gospel was attacked in Paul's missionary journey, many ways. In this particular journey, we're going to look at two things. First, we're going to see that the false teachers, they tried to duplicate what he was doing. And the other thing is that there were riots. People were opposed to the gospel, and they began to riot. And as we do our mission, that's to be expected. It is to be expected. So it says that Paul went to Ephesus, and he went to the synagogue, and he was teaching in the synagogue. Some people believed, some people did not believe. And then he took some disciples, and he went to a place called Tyrannus, to a hall of Tyrannus. And he began to teach for almost 2 years, just instructing the people in the ways of God. And as Paul was doing this, the Lord was good because he used him in a mighty way. And regardless of the challenges that we'll face as we do God's mission, you need to understand God still works. When we allow him to work, he'll still use us no matter what we face. And he begins by saying here that God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick, and their illnesses were cured, and the evil spirits left them. And then these false teachers, when they saw that God is using Paul, some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who were demon-possessed. They would say, in the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches, I command you to leave. Then you have this copycats who will try to do the same thing. And when it comes to the gospel, it's like I'm reminded of a $100 bill. It's very difficult for the common person to differentiate a real $100 bill and a fake one. It's not easy. When you see it, you can't really tell. There are people who are very good, but you know, most of the time, like myself, I cannot tell. So it has to go through a special machine, then they can tell you that it's fake. But they all look the same just by the looks of it. And also I want you to consider a glass of water. A glass of water and a glass of whiskey, they look the same. But we all know that they are not the same. If I give my son a glass of water, nothing's happened. But if I give him a glass of whiskey, then I'll end up in trouble. So sometimes Satan does the same thing. He wants to duplicate what God is doing. And he does it on purpose so that he can hinder what God is doing in our lives. And we see here in this particular example that these false teachers, you know, They'll do the same thing in the name of Jesus or the name of whatever Paul is doing. They want to do the same things. But in reality, they were not doing it because they love the people. They were not doing it because they were called by God. They were doing it for themselves, for whatever reasons, for their selfish ambitions. And I was wondering, why handkerchiefs? Why? And as I was thinking about this, I came to learn that sometimes God will do certain things at certain times. We may not know why, but sometimes he has a way of doing things depending on the culture or the environment of that time. I can tell you, when I first became a believer, just maybe 1 year after I became a believer, I didn't know the Bible at all, but I wanted to preach the gospel and tell people about the love. I was so excited about the love of Jesus. And I remember one time telling people, God helps those who help themselves. Have you heard that before? You hear this all the time. It's nowhere in the Bible, but somehow I don't know why I got it. I just hear people say, and I remember standing before people and challenging people to come to Christ and say, you need to help yourself. If you don't help yourself, how can God help you? But the interesting thing is there are people who still came to know Christ. Not because I was preaching the truth. It's just that sometimes God is gracious. He sees that this is a new believer. He's trying. God was still God. But really, right now, when I stand before people and tell people God helps those who help themselves, it's bad. I've grown throughout the years, and I know the truth. I can't preach like that. And so here we see that the people are bringing handkerchiefs. You know, they are taking them, and then they are getting healed. Not because the handkerchiefs themselves were magical, there was something about it. It was actually God doing it. But somehow, God just allowed that. So it's not something that later it will become a pattern for believers that everywhere you go with a handkerchief and then you tell people to touch it for their healing. And in fact, the reason why we have the book of Leviticus is because when the Israelites left Egypt, they were thinking like the Egyptians. So God had to save them. But still their ways and how they were doing things were still like Egyptians. So the book of Leviticus, one of the main themes of the book of the Leviticus is that people were being taught how to properly worship God. That's why we have the book of Leviticus. Now, all the details so that people can learn the ways of God. And in fact, the Ten Commandments were given so that people can have a biblical worldview, a godly worldview. That's why they have the Ten Commandments. That's why we say they don't save us, but they help us to understand God's will and how to think godly. That's why we have the Ten Commandments. So, the handkerchiefs themselves is something that just God used at that time. And you need to understand the people are very, very superstitious in Ephesus. So that would be a normal thing for them to do. But still, God had to honor that. And there were some people who came were healed. Unlike today, we see in our society today, there are people groups who will do the same thing. And the difference here is that the way they do today is that piece of cloth of handkerchief is actually being commissioned by the preachers. They commission that and they anoint it. And it has, you know, so they'll give it to the people. You take it home, put it under your pillow, and maybe God is going to heal you. And that's not the only thing. When you hear handkerchiefs being used today, they are used as a way of fundraising. So you take the piece of cloth, take it home, put it under your table or under your pillow and sleep over it. God is going to heal you. Or if God doesn't heal you, you bring back the handkerchief. But when you bring it back, you have to plant a seed. You come with a seed. So the seed, basically, you put an envelope, and then you use it, and then the man of God will pray for you. And if God doesn't heal you, what happens? Keep on planting the seed. Maybe last time you gave $500. Maybe God wants you to give $1,000. Maybe he wants to give you $2,000. Keep on planting the seed until you experience your breakthrough. Trust me, what I'm telling you is something that I have seen. It happens all the time. And this is what the false teachers do sometimes. They try to copy, but there's so much deception in it. And they do this for their own financial gain. And the Bible tells us the identity of these people. They were actually priests who were doing this. So we don't know what kind of priests were doing this, the sons of Siva. We don't know because the Bible doesn't really talk much about them. But there's a possibility that they were children of priests. These were people who started well, maybe. But then at some point, they fell. And they began to teach heresy, bad teachings. Or it could be that there are people who just appointed themselves as prophets. And they are doing this. And many Christians today are victims of false teachers. And that's one of the strategies that Satan uses all the time. There are so many false teachers out there deceiving people in the name of Jesus Christ. And sometimes when they talk, you'll hear them say something that sounds like faith in God. But really, when you think about it, it's not really faith in God. Do you need a new job? Do you need a raise? God is able to do that. Name it and claim it by faith, and then it's yours. Do you need healing from a disease? Command God, and he must obey your word of faith. So some of you are wondering, why can't we pray like that, Pastor? I'm sure, yes, you can, but I want to say this to you. Sometimes there are things we do, it sounds like it's faith in God, but when you think about it deeply, it's not really faith in God. And I'm going to show you how. I think it's a question of, we need to reflect upon this thing, who is God? I've met a lot of parents today who complain about their kids. And even myself, I've seen it in my own kids. And so one of the complaints is that sometimes parents feel that their kids have taken authority from them. A kid will be going to ask you, Dad, I need can I use my iPad? The parents will say, okay, go ahead and use it. I'll give you half an hour. After half an hour, okay, can I have the iPad now? The kid will say, no. And start to respond back, why can't I use it? Why can't I keep it longer? And they start to argue. Then the parent will give up and say, okay, I'll give another 15 minutes. After 15 minutes, when I take that iPad, they get upset with you, they go crazy, and sometimes some parents just give up. You know, so it's a struggle. And if the parent decides maybe to discipline the kid, he has to be very, very careful in how he disciplines the kid, because you can discipline a kid in a way that you can get into trouble. And you can be called, so there could be accused of being abusive. So parents complain. They say sometimes we feel that, we are serving our kids. That authority is gone. It's a common thing that you hear from parents. You feel helpless. What happened to that parent authority where you can just say things as a parent and your kids can listen to you? That's changing in our culture today. And that's what these false teachers are doing. So when they tell you that, claim it, name it and claim it by faith, receive it's yours. It might sound like faith in God, but maybe it's not, because we're actually commanding God and We are robbing God of his authority. Is God allowed to speak? Sometimes we make him a servant. We become the kings and the queens. And if he doesn't answer according to our will, then we find other ways. And the false preachers will tell you, keep on planting that seed until you get a breakthrough. Which means that you don't like the answer that God gave you. I'll keep on planting, I'll keep on bribing God until I get a breakthrough. God becomes like an ATM machine, basically. I don't need to relate to him. I just demand what I want, and he must do it to me. He becomes our servant. So I don't see that as faith at all, because true faith, I believe, sounds like this. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, they said to King Nebuchadnezzar, who wanted him to worship his idol, he said, we do not need to defend ourselves before you on this matter, King Nebuchadnezzar. We're not going to worship your God. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it. So they had faith that God was able to deliver them. But again, they left room for God to be God. And this is what they say here. But even if he doesn't do it, we are still not going to worship your God. So they trusted in God, but God still remains to be God. God was not their servant. He said, okay, God, I trust you, but let your will be done. But the false preachers, that's not what they tell you. They say, you command him. He must give it to you by faith because you have faith. And if he doesn't give it to you, maybe because you don't have enough faith. And because you don't have enough faith, keep on planting that seed until you shake heaven. I don't think so. I don't think so. God must be God. He must be God. Now you see here that the false teachers can damage the church. And you say, well, that's maybe doesn't apply to me. It applies to preachers because sometimes preachers get corrupt. But it affects everybody. It affects the people. It affects you. You can become a victim. In verse 13 and 16, the false preachers were exposed. As God has ways of exposing these false preachers, false teachers. Now here they are exposed. What happens is that they tried to do that to a man who was demon-possessed. And guess what happened? The man responded back to them and said, I know Paul, I know Jesus. Who are you? Who are you? I mean, we don't teach people to listen to demons. They are liars all the time, right? They lie to us and so on. But this is an interesting story because even the demons, they say, you know what? We are liars ourselves, but what you guys are doing, this is a bit too much. We know Paul. We know Jesus. But man, we have never seen that before. Who are you? And the Bible says they grab these false teachers to the point of beating them up. It's a funny story, and this reminds me of a gentleman who was looking. This gentleman was looking for a job, and he learned that there was a local zoo that was hiring. So he put his application. He said, "I'd like to go. You know, I'd apply for a job." So when he got there, they said, "Here, we'd like to hire you, but the work is a bit unusual. I hope you like it." I said, no problem, man. I'm looking for work. You know, I'm ready to do anything. I said, sure. So this is the thing. In our zoo, one of our gorillas just died. But we don't want to lose business, and we don't want to tell people that it died. So what we want is that we want you to put on a suit, a gorilla suit and pretend that you're a gorilla. And all what you do is that you sleep, you know. The tourists will come, they throw some nuts, you get some nuts, eat some nuts, jump around, pretend you're the gorilla. And, you know, that's all what you do. The guy liked the job, just sleep and eat nuts and entertain people. No problem. So he did that. And he was very, very good. People, the tourists will come and take some pictures. No, this is a gorilla. So one day he got so excited, he was jumping around. And he went so high, and then he jumped. He fell on the other side on the lion's cage. Now he was scared because, you know, he was faking. He was scared and he was thinking, oh, man, now I'm going to die. He started screaming for help. Help! Help! The lion came and cornered him. Then it whispered to him, the lion whispered to him and said, shut up. They're going to fire both of us if you keep on going. So the lion was a fake too. And who knows, there were zebras and other animals, they were all fake. But the people were cheering. And that's what the false prophets do. You know, there are lots of false prophets. People cheer them, people love them. You tell people the truth, people don't want to hear the truth. People want to go to places where they can be entertained. So this is real. And in all culture, it's happening all the time. Like on YouTube, there are all kinds of false teachers everywhere. This is a weapon that Satan does to destroy the church and the people of God. But the good news here is that the message that Paul preached, he was consistent. And it brought very good results. In verse 18 to 20, it says here, many of those who believe now came openly, confessed what they had done. A number had practiced sorcery, brought their scrolls together, and burned them publicly. Then they articulated the value. When they articulated the value of the scrolls, the total came to 50,000 drachmas. I don't know what that is. Okay, but here's the thing: is that Paul maintained with the truth, and many, many, many people still came to know Christ. Regardless of this confusion that comes in the lives of God's people, I can assure you that God is still faithful. He's still faithful, and we're still going to see people come to Christ because God still works. Has the gospel changed you? Has the gospel made a difference in your life? Because when you hear the gospel, it transforms, it changes. And these people, they brought all their magic items. They burnt them because of the gospel. And that's what is expected of us. When we come to know Christ, we have to live that old life. Some of these preachers can take us back to that old life. And the Bible tells us, dear children, keep yourselves away from idols. And in Galatians 4 says, formerly, when you did not know God, you were enslaved to those that by nature are not gods. But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world? Those whose slaves you want to be once more. So basically, we are being reminded we can't be slaves to these things. We have been set free. The gospel transforms us. It changes us. And we can trust God in a meaningful way. Now, verse 21 to 41, it now talks about a riot. So first we looked at the false teachers twisting the gospel. Now we see another opposition where now there's a huge riot now. And this riot here involved a silversmith named Demetrius. So this person, he made idols. And he earned his living by making idols. It's a big industry in Ephesus. So when people were worshiping idols, and they were listening to the false gospel, what happens is that this business thrived, did very, very well. But now he had to organize a riot because when people are being delivered and coming to Christ, they were losing business. And I like this guy here because he was at least honest. He was saying, you know what, when you guys preach the gospel, it transforms people. We are losing money. And it's also not good for our God. We have our God here, Artemis. It's not good for him. At least he was honest. He was telling the truth. So he actually, maybe he knew the truth, but the thing is, he just wanted to suppress the truth. So people oppose the gospel because it confronts their sinful lifestyles. That is to be expected. In our mission, we're going to share the good news, preach the gospel. It's going to confront the people's lifestyles. So the city of Ephesus was known as one of the seven wonders of the world. So all these women, prostitutes, they came to this particular idol here, not dressed properly, and that's what brought the business in this city. Now, Demetrius and his fellow workers are scared of losing business. So, Demetrius and his followers should have said this. Is the message that Paul and others are proclaiming, is it true? That's what he was supposed to say that. Is it true? If it's true, we are in big trouble before the creator of the universe. Because we have not only worshipped this stupid idol, we've misled many people to practice idolatry. That was what he was supposed to say. If Paul's message is true, we need to find another line of work. But instead, they accused the missionaries. So they were supposed to embrace it and say, if it's true, we need to do something because we are misleading people. We are misleading people. But instead, they chose to oppose the missionaries. Now, my brothers and sisters, we will be accused. We will be opposed. And we should not be surprised as we take God's mission. And today, we don't see riots like those days. It happens in other countries, but it's not something that we see. Riots all the time. People rioting because they don't want us to come to church, or they're rioting because we have come here to worship. But Christians today, we are accused many times in what we call today as hate speech. That's becoming very, very popular. You can't say anything today in the name of Jesus Christ. You are going to be accused of hate speech. A working definition of hate speech is like this. It says, a speech that is intended to insult, intimidate, or cause prejudice against a person or people based on their race, gender, sexual orientation, political affiliation, occupation, disability, or physical appearance. That's the definition. But if that's if this is the definition of hate speech, then it's okay for Christians not to participate in hate speech. We shouldn't be hating other people if this is the definition. But the problem is that this definition is expanding. And now they have included, they say, proclaiming that a certain belief is wrong or that a certain activity is sinful based on biblical principles. It's increasing being included in the definition of hate speech. That's where the problem is. So in other words, when you say a certain activity is sinful based on biblical principles, you are a hater. But that's not true. Because it's not hateful for a teacher to tell their student that they are wrong. Actually, it's because they love them. If your teacher tells you you are wrong, they want you to excel. They love you. They love you. It's not hateful for a building inspector to tell a construction company that they are building on a faulty foundation. It's not. So they're just telling you, hey, that foundation where you're building your house is not a good place, because they love you. Why would I stand there? I see a builder building in a faulty foundation. If I care, I love, I'm going to sell the truth. Christians, we love. We don't hate. And when we confront sin, when we tell people about the love of God, when we quote the Bible, it's because we love them. It's because we love them. Because we love them. Later, the Apostle Paul says in the book of Ephesians 6:12, he says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly realm. It is a real spiritual warfare. In our mission, we need to be prepared. We need to be ready. It will come, and it is here already. And then finally, in verse 19, 21, and 22, this is what Paul says. After all this has happened, he has encountered the false teachers. He has encountered a mob that wanted to, you know, to hinder God's work. He continued to be faithful in the mission of God. But what I like about him is that he was still faithful in proclaiming the word of God. But then this is what he says. After all this had happened, Paul decided to go to Jerusalem. He was still thinking big. His experience in Ephesus did not stop him from going to the next city. He still desired to go to Rome and continue to proclaim the word of Jesus Christ. So in other words, he took the Great Commission very, very, very seriously. And I believe that when we think about our mission, it's an important mission. We need to take it very seriously. And we should desire that not only us, but other people need to hear that great news of the kingdom. The Bible says, go, make disciples of all nations. So now here Paul is ready to continue in a world vision where he must visit Rome. Then he sent, you know, before he left, you know, Ephesus, he sent Timothy, another his goer, to go ahead of him just to clear the way. But he was going. That was his desire. Whether he got there, but that was his desire. It was an important mission, and it had to be carried out. So we cannot be disappointed. We cannot give up. It's an important mission. We need to obey Jesus Christ and fulfill that mission. Amen. That's our mission. Challenges are going to be there. Internally, we're going to see confusion. False teachers are going to work so hard to destroy what God has given us. But God has a way of dealing with them. People will oppose. But God has a way of getting hold of these people and bringing them back to the kingdom of God. One of them was Paul himself. He was a stubborn man trying to hinder God's work. But in his road to Damascus, he met the resurrected Christ. And he became an instrument. Now, he's being a good example for you and I. Amen. Amen.
Let's stand together as we sing our closing hymn. The closing hymn is Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, and I would encourage you to use this as a prayer to ask God that he would use each one of us to be his instrument of peace.
channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, you pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, you faith in you. Oh, Master, grant that I may to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. When there's despair,
Jesus Christ, we want to thank you, Lord, and I thank you, Lord, as we continue to reflect upon your mission, and you tell us that as the Father called you, you have also called us, Lord, and we are called, Lord, to be obedient and to stand firm, oh Lord. We will face many challenges, but Lord Jesus Christ, we know that we'll be successful, just like the way Paul was successful, Lord. And our desire today, Lord, is to continue that great work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.